Well, hi everyone. I'm so sorry that I can't join you in person for the high noon for the IANA transition panel. I really apologize for not being able to make it down my street and through my neighborhood. Is Steve Crocker there?
Yes.
Okay, so we have everyone in person except for me and Alyssa. We had a little connectivity problem. But I think in the interest of time and to get started, why don't I allow the panelists who are there in person to introduce themselves briefly to the audience, if you may.
Sure. Steve Del Bianco, Executive Director of NetChoice, been a 10-year member at ICANN, where I chair the policy for the business constituency. And I'm also an appointed member to the cross-community working group that is trying to work out the right accountability plan for the transition, the IANA transition, for which today is apparently high noon. Thank you.
Steve Crocker, Chairman of the Board of ICANN. I'm just here to find out what's happening.
David Rettle, I'm the Chief Counsel for the Republicans on the House Energy and Commerce Committee.
Greg Shatton. I'm a lawyer in private practice in New York at Abelman, Frayn, and Schwab. I'm also the president of the intellectual property constituency of ICANN. I am an appointed member of the cross-community working group on the IANA stewardship transition, representing the commercial stakeholder group, and I'm a participant in the cross-community working group on enhancing ICANN's accountability, and I don't get enough sleep.
And I'm Chris Wilson with 21st Century Fox. I'm a vice president for government affairs. I am the company's point person on internet governance policy issues. As of January 4th, I'm currently serve as the chair of ICANN's business constituency, the business and commercial users of the internet, and have been actively following the accountability work that's been taking place over these many months.
Okay, and I want to mention that we also have Alyssa Cooper, who is on this panel, and we'll try to get her in here. Many of you know her, Dr. Alyssa Cooper. She's a distinguished engineer in the collaboration technology group at Cisco Systems. She was previously the chief computer scientist at the Center for Democracy and Technology. She has a PhD from Oxford Internet Institute and is someone that many of us know currently at Cisco. So we'll try to get Alyssa in when we can. Thank you very much for introducing yourselves. I think to set the stage for this panel, it would be helpful for all of us to have a little bit of scope in history of what we're talking about when we talk about the transition. What exactly are we talking about when we say transition of U.S. administration of the IANA functions? There have been a lot of different descriptions of this, ranging from that being clerical functions to calling it a lot of inflammatory things. So maybe I could ask Steve Crocker, who is probably the best person positioned to give some history and a brief description of what exactly is it we're talking about, what tasks pertain to the IANA functions. Steve Crocker, if you don't mind beginning.
Thank you very much, Laura. So I'll give you my perspective, and then you get to hear different people's perspective. The IANA function was fundamentally a clerical function of publishing information related to three areas. The fact that they become distinguished as three areas is kind of an emergent history. But once upon a time, as protocols were developed, there were a number of tables and ancillary information that needed to be published related to these protocols that were developed by the IETF. John Postel, who was part of the original team from the very beginning back in the days that we were at UCLA, took on this task and on behalf of the community continued it for a very long time. Eventually, the domain name system was invented, and he had a part in that, and he helped foster the distribution of top-level domain names and the management of the root zone. I'm compressing quite a bit of history. And along the way, there's also the allocation of address blocks, and the regional internet registries emerged, five across the globe over time. And but there was the, and I'm not going to be very precise about the order of things because some of these took place slightly out of order. The allocation of large address blocks of IPv4 addresses and autonomous system numbers, and eventually IPv6 addresses. In the latter part of the 1990s, it became evident that the operation that he was carrying out more or less out of his back pocket as he was a researcher at the University of Southern California, had grown beyond manageable bounds. And again, compressing a lot of history, which I look around the room and I see at least a few people participated in this, led to the creation of ICANN, which from my perspective, I would say is this. ICANN was purpose-built to be the home of the IANA function. We now are finding ourselves 15 years or more, 18 years later, in a discussion in which, in a somewhat peculiar way, the view of ICANN is, well, maybe it isn't the right home for the IANA function, and that reflects that an awful lot of other stuff got freighted onto the onto ICANN, the oversight of the generic names system, the registries and the registrars and so forth, and a lot of politics related to internet governance. The arrangement that led to the creation of ICANN was via the U.S. government, and in particular through NTIA, which is part of the Department of Commerce, two relationships, two contractual or semi-contractual relationships were set up, one of which was a memorandum of understanding, and the other was a formal contract, although somewhat peculiar in its nature because no money changed hands, for ICANN to carry out the IANA function on behalf of the community. And it was envisioned in 1998 when this was set up that this was a temporary arrangement and eventually, say, in a long time in the distant future, like 2 years into the year 2000, this would be transitioned away from the U.S. government. It took quite a bit longer, of course, and now, almost 2 years ago, March 14th, 2014, came the announcement that the U.S. government intended to finally back away from or extricate itself from this no-cost contract that it had had all this time with ICANN to perform this function. A comment, more or less, and I'm putting a little bit of spin on this, a comment along that announcement was, let's make sure that everybody's comfortable with this, and that opened up the door for a wide set of discussions. And the discussions broke into basically two parts. One was on the IANA function itself, and what followed from that was the names community, the numbers community, and the protocol community. Each went off to look at their needs for the IANA function and then produce a coordinated composite proposal. And I think in the Laura, in your introduction of Alyssa, should also mention that she's a co-chair of the ICG that coordinates the assemblage of those three proposals from the operational communities, a very important role. That work went along at a reasonable clip, but a second large question was opened up, which is, oh, this must be the time to reconsider the governance of ICANN itself from top to bottom. And that opened up this cross-community working group on accountability for ICANN, which has been where most of the focus has been for the last many months. We're now at a point where the CCWG's proposal is nearing completion. I think we're at version 3 with some modifications or some additions to it. And the Department of Commerce is very eager to have this proposal reach conclusion so that the board can forward it to them and they can say whether or not this meets the conditions that they originally had set up. And we fully expect that it will, and then we can proceed with the details of the implementation of the transition function. The details of the transition with respect to the IANA function itself involve making a little clearer what the visibility is of IANA transactions, all the way to the point of creating a subordinate corporation or subordinate legal entity called PTI that will be the housing of the same functions that ICANN carries out and operated as much as possible as it is today, doing as little change and as little violence to it. And then the other aspect is a whole series of changes to the bylaws of ICANN as a corporation to increase its accountability, to increase its transparency, and a lot of tussles, some of which are based, again, this is very straight, very clearly, it was my opinion, some of which are based upon old battles being refought, and some of which are based on anticipation of possible problems that, if they had occurred, might have been resolved by the Department of Commerce, but with no particular evidence that that was ever the case. Does that put enough hooks and handles for people to respond to?
Thank you very much, Steve Kroger. Let me ask Steve Del Bianco to elaborate a little bit more on that. And Steve, if you could, can you explain at a very high level exactly what is the nature of the U.S. government relationship to the IANA functions now, and specifically, what were some of the criteria that were laid out for the transition to occur?
Yeah, thank you, Laura. I mean, to up-level it a bit, the genius of Steve Crocker and his colleagues in the 1980s created the Internet protocols, and apart from saying that this is about the U.S. giving away the Internet, we should all know that in 1980, we published the recipe on how to use Internet protocols to set up an IP network, gave it away to the world, and that was a recipe that any country, any state could follow if it had even a switch telephone network. Remember the modems that we used to use to do Internet connectivity. Now, in that recipe, there wasn't just the protocols that Dr. Crocker invented, but there were also other ingredients that you needed to cook that up in the recipe. And one was IP numbers, and the other was domain names. And those were a little less easy to sort of publish a recipe and let people run with it. And that's why, as Dr. Crocker instructed, the U.S. government in 1998 created ICANN to privatize and internationalize those two key functions, that notion of giving up the numbers and then managing those top-level domain names. But when the U.S. created ICANN, it created it without having members, which is typically the case with a California nonprofit public benefit corporation. And that meant that the Internet community had no capability to do what members typically do with a nonprofit corporation. Things like being able to block a budget, being able to challenge a decision that the board had made, challenge it as a community, and to be able to have some redress to it, to be able to block changes to bylaws or approve changes to other bylaws. These are a handful of powers that the community lacked. And we had a very imperfect mechanism to get them done. And the imperfect mechanism was this notion that the U.S. government held this leash called the IANA contract that Steve described. And that might be a very crude and hardly ever used, but it was all we had as a way to hold the corporation accountable to the community. And that's why this transition created perhaps the only opportunity to bring into the mix some of the powers that I've just described, are the notion of blocking a budget or blocking a bylaw, challenging a decision, spilling the board of directors if they weren't being attentive to the interests of the community. So look, it's taken a year to work the details out on this plan, but it's pretty close to fruition, and it's very close to meeting the requirements put forth by NTIA, requirements that we protect the security and stability, protect the notion of free expression, to ensure that no government or intergovernmental entity could step into the shoes that the U.S. government had filled when it fulfilled the IANA contract. And I really feel that thanks to the work of the community and the hundreds of meetings and thousands of man hours, we are very close to getting that done right now.
Well, let me ask either Chris or Greg or David. Yes. Oh, hello, Alyssa. Welcome. Well, let's ask Alyssa this question then. You know, at a very high level, how would you describe the proposals that are currently on the table? Like, if someone didn't know that much about the backstory and the history, how would you describe the state of the proposals that are currently on the table, and where does the transition now stand? That might be a good question for Alyssa. Let's see if we can hear you.
Sure, I can try to answer that. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can. Can the room?
Yes.
Okay. Great. So as Steve Crocker pointed out in his opening remarks, there's really two tracks of work that have gone into the transition, and therefore there are two proposals that are at issue today. The one that my group worked on, the ICG, is the proposal related to the transition of the stewardship of the IANA functions themselves. So I'll call that one the transition proposal, and the other one's the accountability proposal. So the transition proposal essentially replaces the stewardship of NTIA with stewardship by the community, and oversight and accountability mechanisms for the IANA functions operator provided by the communities of interest. As Steve noted, there's really three communities with some blurry boundaries between them, but one of them relates to the domain names, one of them relates to the IP addressing infrastructure, and one to the protocol parameters. And so for there's a proposal component for each of those three cases, and really in each case, the proposal is modeled on a customer to service provider relationship. So there's some agreement or contract that already exists or would be set up at transition time to allow each of those three communities to hold the IANA functions operator responsible for carrying out the functions in accordance with the community's wishes. And so this ensures that each of the organizations and individuals who are already involved with making use of the IANA functions and holding the IANA functions operator responsible will continue to be able to do that. As Steve said, the proposal does include the creation of a subsidiary of ICANN known as the Post-Transition IANA or PTI. And basically what would happen at transition time is that currently the IANA is really, it's just a department within ICANN. So what would happen at transition time is that that department would move into this subsidiary. But in terms of the people who fill out these clerical roles and their sort of operational structure, none of that would really change. It would just move to a different entity, still within ICANN as a subsidiary. So that's kind of the very high-level guts of the transition proposal. I think there's other panelists who can speak much more in much more depth to the accountability proposal. But the current status is that from the transition proposal perspective, the ICG and the communities have completed their work. We've just been waiting since October for the accountability proposal work to finish because there's a dependency between the domain names portion of the transition proposal and the work that's currently going on in the accountability group. So we're basically waiting for the accountability group to finish and for the domain names community to give a signal that the accountability work meets the requirements of the transition proposal, and then we'll be ready to send the proposals off to NTIA via the ICANN board.
Thank you very much, Alyssa. Appreciate it. And you mentioned turning over as part of the transition the mechanism from NTIA to communities of interest. And I know down at the other end of the table there, we have Chris, Greg, and David who could speak to some aspects of that. So I can see you a little bit. Who would like to comment more about the transition proposals and how they represent communities of interest and some of the unique stakeholder considerations that are playing into this?
Well, this is Greg Schatt, and I'll take a first crack at it. I'm sure there'll be some follow-up. The accountability proposal, which has been hashed out over the last year, basically breaks down into 12 recommendations, but they are, to some extent, interconnected. The idea, essentially, is that we've created an empowered community that will provide a method for the different stakeholder groups, advisory groups that participate in ICANN and all those that they represent to have an oversight voice. And specifically, powers have been created that will, through the use of a so-called designator, provide powers to remove a director, remove the entire board, to approve bylaws or reject bylaws that will move elements of the affirmation of commitments, which is another agreement between ICANN and the U.S. government, into the bylaws of ICANN, also to improve various forms of redress. I see Bertrand de la Chapelle has walked in, so the word redress came to me immediately. Particularly the request for reconsideration system, and also the IRP, the independent review panel process, being significantly overhauled to provide more constructive redress for the various communities. And the empowered community is essentially creates a it's almost like a cross-community working group in a sense, but it requires that the communities together, the different groups such as the generic name supporting organization, which includes stakeholders from registries, registrars, civil society, and business, and the country code supporting organization, which includes the country registry operators, and the other organizations, ALAC, GAC, apologies for the acronyms, will need to kind of work together to empower this designator to take actions if ICANN is going places that the community feels that it shouldn't, or to take action if various actions or inactions are taking place that the community objects to. At this point, I would say that having been through three drafts and working through in second and third reading on the third draft changes, where we've taken into account public comments, including comments from the ICANN board, comments from some of the supporting organizations, but we're still waiting for others, and the GNSO just delivered its first set of feedback within the last 2 to 3 days, so that has not even really been considered yet by the CCWG. Over the next very few weeks, we will be issuing a supplemental draft, which will really be the fourth draft in a way, or a third and a half draft. In one way to sound optimistic, I would say there are probably fewer than 10 significant open issues left, and some of the recommendations have no significant open issues left. On the other hand, I think some of the issues are the most intractable ones. That's why they have not been resolved up until now. And some of them actually go to the core of the proposal. So there is going to need to be some very important and relatively quick consensus building on these last points for us to really get to where we need to get to, and for Dave to have something to give advice to his congressman on.
Thank you very much. And David or Chris, maybe you could add to that. And I'd like to also transition into some further elaboration of what are some of these intractable issues and the sticking points. What are some of the open issues that still need to be resolved?
So, Laura, I think actually maybe it gets to sort of one general question. This is a general question, frankly, that's been posed to me inside my own company, is why does this matter? Why does all of this matter to us? Why does this matter to the public generally, et cetera? And I think there's two prongs to that answer. One, this is a litmus test on multi-stakeholderism, as we heard from Larry Strickling earlier and Bertrand. There are a variety of different venues where this takes place, but I think this ICANN is ultimately seen as the bellwether make multi-stakeholder entity out there, at least within the internet governance space. And if anything, we've learned over the months since the transition was announced that multi-stakeholderism is messy. This has been a messy affair, to be sure. As Steve Crocker's alluded to, there have been some divisions on issues, new issues, and some old issues as well. And I think that's actually healthy. And secondly, this matters because the commercial internet, for all intents and purposes, has reached the age of majority. It can vote. It can go to war. It's an adult at this point in time, and concomitant with that, there are major policy issues that come with being an adult and having more responsibility. And I think as we've learned throughout the CCWG accountability work, those issues are coming to the fore. One of the major outstanding issues currently is the scope of ICANN's mission. Going forward post-transition. There are differences of opinion on what exactly that entails. There are certain constituencies that would prefer ICANN truly remain a technical body focusing on the technical functions of the internet. I think that ship has sailed, quite frankly. Certainly has sailed 5 years ago with the release of the new generic top-level domain names. And there are a variety of policy issues that, like, or interplay with that, not the least of which is issues on who is and privacy issues about contract compliance, registries and registrars being held to a standard of good business, et cetera. So that mission the confines of the mission, I think, continues to be in discussion. I do think we are near a point where we're going to come to consensus on that. But certainly from my point of view, that is one of the top level issues that we still need to figure out.
Yes, thank you very much. And David, a perspective on any of this, but in particular, what are some of the open issues that need to be resolved?
Well, I think Chris hit the nail on the head with this being a bellwether for the larger debate over multi-stakeholderism versus multilateralism. And certainly that's something that we're paying close attention to on Capitol Hill. Governments don't like to be on equal footing with non-governments, and we're seeing that play out throughout this process. There have been multiple plays by the GAC to be the advisory committee that's created a little more equal than other advisory committees. And so we're paying close attention to the way things get put back together. I grew up in an auto shop, for better or for worse. And as it turns out, a couple things I learned from my father: if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Well, we're already down that road. We're trying to fix something that wasn't broken. So having already taken the engine apart, we now have to put all those pieces back together. And as it turns out, if you get done putting a car back together and you got a couple extra bolts, you should be worried. Because it might sound good in the short term, but sooner or later something's going to rattle off the car. And so as things start to get put back together, this is a lot of what the stress tests were about. And we were paying very close attention to the stress tests on Capitol Hill. And this was an issue that my bosses raised early and raised often. And to the community's credit, they took them very seriously and have been addressing them head on since then. But we are certainly paying attention to see what this thing is going to look like and make sure that the internet, which is without doubt the greatest engine of communications and commerce we've ever known, continues to be so in the same vein that we've always known it. And while we can quibble about whether or not the IANA functions are trivial or not, I think, you know, Crocker got it spot on at the very beginning of this. It's become part of a larger debate about internet governance. I mean, this is no longer simply about who's going to make sure that IANA transactions are valid. It's about a larger debate over internet governance, and we're certainly paying attention on that front.
Okay, well, thank you very much for describing the importance of it and putting it in the broader context of internet governance debates about internet sovereignty approaches and multilateral versus multi-stakeholder. But given the importance, would there be someone on the panel that could explain to us what some of these last open issues are that need to be resolved in the coming months? Steve?
I can give you one of them, Laura.
Okay.
The infamous stress test 18 suggested that the governments at ICANN, they have this special privilege right now where if they give advice to ICANN and ICANN chooses not to take the advice, it must try and find a mutually acceptable solution, and that's only available to this government advisory committee, and it's quite a bit of deference to governments. And stress test 18 surfaced a particular, something that was missing from our bylaws, was this notion that when the governments come up with their advice, what's the method? Are they allowed to have divided advice where 60% of the countries feel one way and 40% feel another way, and then put ICANN in the ridiculous position of having to arbitrate between divided opinions among sovereign governments? ICANN was never purpose-built to do that. And so stress test 18 said to avoid ever having that happen and giving the governments that kind of divided power, we should ensure that the governments always use the current United Nations method to make their decisions, and that is strong support in the absence of any formal objection. So the answer to that stress test in response to David Reddle and his boss's committee was to change the bylaws to require the governments to use that current rule for decision making. Laura, that's one sticking point because the governments are not very happy about that at all. And in the spirit of multi-stakeholder negotiation and recognizing that the governments are stakeholders as well, we proposed a compromise on that at roughly the Thanksgiving period, where we would increase the number of votes that ICANN's board needed to ignore or resist GAC advice, and in return, the governments would stick to that strong consensus in the absence of any objection. So it's a way to slightly increase the votes it took on the board, but to dramatically increase the consensus level that governments have to have. That's one sticking point, and I think Chris covered the other significant one with respect to the enforcement of contracts that are outside of the technical capability of ICANN, but do touch upon the things that ICANN does. One example is these new top-level domains. Somebody proposed .bank as a new top-level domain, and in their proposal, they promised that they would only allow registrants to the left of the .bank if they were chartered financial institutions. They further promised to add value by suggesting that they would regulate the content and use of the domains that are registered in .bank. So that's true of WellsFargo.bank, but it would never be true of WellsFargo.com or any other combination. And this was done as a way to propose adding value by expanding the domain name space. I think it's precisely what we had in mind when we expanded the domain name space. And yet, those promises made by the .bank registry operator have got to be enforceable by somebody. And guess who's on the other side of that contract? ICANN. So this brings ICANN squarely into the governance on the internet, even though it is all about governments of the internet. It isn't as clean and neat as Bertrand would have us believe in the last panel. And I think that the debate now is, will those kinds of contracts be permissible in the future? And will the ones that have already been signed in the past be enforceable from now on?
Well, let me give one of the Dr. C's, Dr. Crocker, Dr. Cooper, the opportunity to weigh in on how the transition is going and the likelihood of this getting wrapped up. What's the time frame ahead for 2016, either one of you?
Melissa, you go first.
Thank you, Steve. I can't imagine why you would want to defer on that question, but I think the timeline that we're currently operating under has, as people know, the current NTIA contract expires in September of this year of 2016. And last year, when NTIA inquired of the communities how much time it would take to implement the proposals, we came back with something that looked like approximately 4 months. So it's important to keep in mind that even once the proposals are done, there are a number of further phases that need to occur before the NTIA contract can actually expire. So first, once the proposals get to NTIA, they need to be reviewed and approved by the U.S. government, and that includes time for Congress to review the proposals. So you need to allow some amount of time for that. I think the original projection was something in the 4 to 5 months range for that process. And then the proposals need to be implemented. Now there's a tremendous effort underway already to do as much of the implementation as can possibly be done in advance of the proposals actually being submitted to NTIA, so it's not as though everyone in the community and at ICANN is sitting around just waiting. There's a lot of preparation happening for the proposals to get implemented, but nevertheless, there's some things that won't take place until the proposals have been approved by the U.S. government, at which point we enter that that implementation phase. So if you add up those time frames and you look at the expiry of the contract in September, we're getting fairly close to the time at which the proposals will need to go to NTIA by the ICANN board in order for all of that to happen before the current contract expiry. Of course, the contract is set to expire this year because it was extended last year using an option within the contract mechanism that has existed for the life of the contract. So this is what has happened. Last year was not the first time the contract was extended in this way, and so there's, in theory, an option of doing that again. Although I will say that speaking with my technical community hat on as someone who is part of the leadership of the IETF and spent a lot of time together with many, many other colleagues in the technical community, we've been waiting a long time for this to occur. In fact, we've been working on the IANA transition probably going back almost a decade now in terms of our work in the IETF community and interactions with NTIA. And so from the technical community perspective, I think we expect the transition to occur this year and to get it done in 2016. And from the transition proposal perspective, as I said earlier, that's been done since October. And so we really are just in a waiting phase where we are expecting the accountability work to wrap up very soon so that we can move on into the U.S. government review and implementation phases.
Okay, thank you very much. I want to ask one more question, and then maybe we could turn it over to the audience. I know quite a few of the people there in the room and know that there'll be a lot of lively discussion and questions coming from the audience if we could get a mic queued up out there. But the question I have is a broad one about the global politics of this and the local politics of it. And if anyone would like to answer these questions, feel free, or else we can turn it over for audience discussion. But one question has to do with U.S. politics. And, you know, we've seen a lot of politicization in the past of this issue. We've seen a little bit less more recently. But what is the likelihood that this could come up in the presidential the election politics in the United States? And then I also have a global question, and feel free to answer either one of this. The IANA functions often get pulled into many different discussions about internet governance, most having nothing to do with the IANA functions, but nevertheless, it does come into the broader geopolitics of the discussions on internet governance. How do we explain that, and do you think that that will change after the transition proceeds, should it proceed this year?
Let me suggest that my friend to the right here, Dave, should speak to the U.S. politics because he's sitting in the middle of it.
As a congressional staffer, I'm smart enough to punt on questions about presidential politics. There's no value I can add there. I can tell you in answering some of the questions that Laura put forward, you know, how can we have a more sort of intelligent discussion on this? You know, outside the Beltway, the internet is monolithic. Let's be honest. You know, the crowd that's listening to this on the internet and that's sitting in the room knows how the internet works, understands the complexities that we're all talking about. But to the vast majority of people around the world, the internet is monolithic. It is the internet. It's not a series of protocols and a bunch of networks that happen to be interconnected. And it's magic. It just works. And people don't want to look deeper than that. And let's be honest, it's a lot of technology is in the same boat. And so a lot of times it's easy to have these discussions at a level that doesn't translate to the kind of detail that we all know needs to be had as part of this discussion. As far as the political impact, speaking solely about the House, which is what I know best since that's where I work, we passed the .com Act with 387 yays. 387 of the members of the House decided that it was a good idea to take a look at this and say, we would like to have a review period, and NTIA, we trust that you will do what you're going to do in terms of making sure that you live up to the standards you've set forth, that the criteria you have put forward will be part of this proposal, and that you'll have ensured that they're in place. To his credit, Assistant Secretary Strickling has assured my bosses on the record that he intends to submit it to Congress for review period in the absence of the .com Act being signed into law. And so we expect that that will happen as soon as he is able to forward something over to us. Will it play into a larger politics towards the end of the year? I'm sure it will. We've had a funds limitation in the appropriations package the last two budget cycles. We are just now getting into the next cycle. You know, it's the fun of working on Capitol Hill. When one's over, you start the next one. We are just getting into the next appropriations cycle, but only time will tell whether or not our colleagues on the appropriations committees are interested in pursuing that another time around. But I would expect that as we get closer and closer to the termination of this contract, that inside the Beltway, it will continue to be a topic of discussion.
This is Greg. I'd just like to answer the, kind of the second part of your question, Laura, which is once this is all done, what will people think? How will people refer to the IANA functions? Will they still be part of the conversation the way they have been? I think the answer to that is no. I think that they've become a construct. They've become a stand-in for larger issues of internet governance, of control of the internet, and for and control of ICANN. And in a sense, they did serve that purpose. They were a leverage or backstop by which the U.S. government could step in subtly bend ICANN back onto the right path, which of course had absolutely nothing to do with the IANA functions themselves, but they did have to do with the fact that it wouldn't be a good thing for ICANN to lose the IANA contract. So as with any contract, you can use it as a tool to ensure good behavior. Once the IANA functions are kind of just packed away again and are really back to the critical but obscure clerical administrative function that they are, they will no longer really serve, I think, as that that tool, that kind of leverage. So, you know, that's the whole reason we got into the enhancing ICANN's accountability game, which we've been playing. And it's far from a game. It's actually very, very serious business. And as Dave refers to the internet being monolithic, the fact that it's seen as one internet, which is another way of saying it, is really at the very base of what we're trying to maintain. One internet, one open internet, which is another of the NTIA criteria for a successful accountability proposal. And if we can't deliver one open internet that works almost like an appliance for most people, then clearly we've failed, and we need to do it with all deliberate speed, with an emphasis on the speed and hopefully not too much more deliberation. Thanks.
Laura, the title of this panel was High Noon for the IANA Transition, and how many of you even knew that the movie High Noon, 1952, paired a really odd couple, Gary Cooper and Grace Kelly, together? And they were in a small western town, and he faced a returning deadly enemy who just got out of prison, and he found out that his own town refused to help him at all. And I want to give a shout out, because the folks in this town, up at the top of Capitol Hill, they did help the community in this case. The .com Act that David described explicitly backs whatever the global internet community comes up with as a proposal for this transition, the accountability. That's what the .com Act instructs the Commerce Department to hold ICANN to. And that kind of expression of confidence in the community is a reflection on the hard work David and his fellow staff members did both in the House and Senate. And they're to be applauded for that. Now, turning to the presidential politics, you probably aren't surprised that Senator Cruz thinks that the administration acted improperly by deciding to complete the transition in 2014. He probably believes that about everything the administration does. And I don't see how a candidate like Hillary Clinton would be required to answer for an Obama administration decision, and I'm sure she would prefer it to be done before she should take office, if she's so fortunate. But there's always the Trump effect. And just December the 15th, at the presidential debate in Las Vegas, he said he would seek to block ISIS from using the internet. He said, quote, ISIS is recruiting through the internet. ISIS is using the internet better than we are using the internet, and it was our idea. And he wants to get our brilliant people from Silicon Valley to find a way to stop ISIS from doing what they're doing. So yes, Laura, you should expect that it will come up at some point in one of the many presidential debates that are held at the general election level. But just like so many other rather rhetorically charged topics, it'll probably come up, it'll be answered or non-answered in 30-second sound bites, and then we'll move on to other issues that are more salient and relevant to the American people. So this transition, I don't think, will be politicized to any degree that would ruin its chances of happening. It's really up to a lot of us in the room and on this panel to continue to work out the remaining issues and to be sure we have met the requirements. And if we do that, I think the Congress, the administration will back it, and this transition will occur.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's turn it to the audience for some comments and questions. And I can't actually see the audience. Maybe we could turn this computer around, or else someone there could moderate the questions. Okay, there we go. Would anyone like to weigh in?
First takers on questions? Phil, it's a half hand.
Okay, hi
there. Okay, Laura, I'm just kind of helping her. I think you already have.
I'm okay with that. That's
other than mentioning your name on the internet.
Can you guys help him out there?
There you go. Just kicked on.
There you go.
That's working. Okay. I just want to observe that once this plan is forwarded to the board, and if the board approves it and sends it on to NTA. Number one, with the supplemental, I think we're looking toward the end of February at the earliest that can happen. So that's really cutting it close, even if everything goes right after that. Number two, talking about politics, I would only observe that there will be oversight hearings, and sitting on the Senate Commerce Committee for its oversight hearing are Senator Ted Cruz and Senator Marco Rubio, two current candidates for the Republican nomination, one of whom has a hold on the dot-com bill in the Senate, the other one is a sponsor of the dot-com bill. But what I want to ask about, David, I thought personally that the best chance dot-com had to be enacted was to be packaged in with the appropriations bill that passed in December, and instead the appropriators didn't do that, and instead they extended the IANA transition funding freeze through September 30th, 2016. I'm not going to try to predict whether there's going to be separate appropriations bills or what's going to happen in September when they have to pass a bill or a continuing, other than we've seen year after year continuings that continue all the restrictions. But what I want to ask you, how much dialogue, without giving anything away, how much dialogue is there between the Authorization Committee, the Commerce Committees, which are really into the details of this, and the appropriators? Is there a good dialogue, or are there limited dialogue and somewhat different perspectives on all this between the Spending Committee and the Authorizing Committee?
Sure. Well, I mean, I can only speak to the staff. You know, the members are the members. So it turns out, despite my better efforts, my bosses do have conversations when I'm not there. And so at the staff level, we have a very good relationship. I mean, staff in the House, we all work with each other a lot. As you can imagine, D.C. Is, despite the fact that it's a big city, it's a small community in a lot of ways. And this is one of those ways. I have a very good relationship with my colleagues on the appropriations committees. But ultimately, the decisions about what goes into an appropriations bill and what doesn't go in is up to the members on the appropriations committee.
I guess to refine it just a bit more, and then I'll end the question. Do you get the feeling that on the appropriation committees there's an understanding of the negative implications if after all the community work and all the promises that this would happen if the freeze is extended again and prevents the administration from completing it, if there's a general feeling on the Hill and at NTIA that what the community's come up with is a good proposal?
The folks that work over at FSGG Appropes, Financial Services and General Government Appropes, are very good, as are the folks at CJS Appropes, who are the ones who deal with NTIA. I certainly think that's a question for them, whether or not they appreciate the scope. They are certainly well-educated on the issue.
Nice, careful answer.
Any other questions from the audience? Or does anybody else want to respond to that?
Otherwise, I have other questions I'd love to ask, but maybe we could have them respond and turn this computer around one more time.
Okay. Oops. Ooh. Nope. Laura, I can still see you. We've lost you on the big screen. And I'm also monitoring Twitter to see if we have any questions.
Okay. I'm still here if you can hear me.
Yep, we can hear you.
Okay.
Lost the audio. Yep. Anyone? Anyone?
We need a presence robot here for Laura.
Okay.
If only we knew somebody at Cisco.
I think you've done such a good job as moderator that you've answered all the questions that this crowd has. Okay, we've lost our official moderator. So I would just ask any last comments that we want to make, and we're going to wrap this panel up, and next thing's cocktails, just letting you know that.
No pressure.
Just one quick comment on the urgency to getting this done right. Remember that the pressure to do this fell upon the administration because governments have long considered the U.S. unique role to be a real sore point. That's what drove this. And it was showing up in other ways, data localization laws and continuing hammering at the United Nations and other places. On the UN taking a unilateral role. Undersecretary Strickling just described on the previous panel in this room, probably in this chair, what the Chinese government has said lately about a multilateral collection. And I have to say that our failure to get this transition done, to have the US let go of its last unique role. That failure would contribute to a renewed push at the UN, the ITU, and the IGF to create a United Nations-based body that would be able to assert control over critical resources like the internet. And my big fear about that is that at some state of the net 2017, we end up complaining about the net of the state, which could be the result.
See what you did there, Steve.
This is Greg. I think just to follow on that, I think that one of the things that's critical for the community in the coming weeks is to look at those remaining open issues, those difficult issues, and to decide either to come to consensus on them or to look at some of them and consider whether they may not be absolutely critical for the transition. There's going to need to be some real sorting out and there's some real flexibility on the part of a number of people. And to some extent, there was a little bit of a gravy train issue, I think, with some of the proposals that have made their way in. And some people are holding on pretty hard to their gravy. I think that we need to step back as, I think Steve Del Bianco sounded some very important big picture issues, and we can sometimes get a little bit small when we're discussing these things. So I think this is, in a sense, not so much, not just high noon for the IANA transition, but at least a, if not high noon for the multi-stakeholder model, a very important crossroads for how we deal with things. Typically, the multi-stakeholder model doesn't get put under such external political pressure as this. So we'll have to see whether that produces a diamond or just gravel.
Well, not one to come in between a panel and room and the networking reception. Why don't I just allow each of the panelists, maybe beginning with Alyssa, to make 1 minute of closing remarks about this issue of the crossroads. And so I'll leave it open-ended. But if you were, if you knew that there was an international listening or viewing audience to this panel, and they didn't get hit by the same blizzard that Washington got hit, what would be the message or the key takeaway that you would want to convey out of this panel, whether it's about the importance of multi-stakeholder governance or the public policy issues at stake or issues related to the stability of the internet? What would be the crossroads issue about why moving forward with this is so important? Maybe starting with Alyssa as a closing thought.
I can see the giant microphone in front of me. So I think as someone, came into this process from the technical community and the IETF in particular, I think it's not surprising at all that to hear people describe the process as messy or, oh, it's taking longer than we thought it would take. If you've ever actually participated in any depth in this kind of process, you know that's exactly how it always is, and that it doesn't come out in a pristine, organized fashion, that everybody is equally dissatisfied with the result, that nobody gets exactly what they want, and that it doesn't always operate on precisely the timetable that you would have expected. That's exactly why we know that this process is representative of how we have always run and governed and operated the internet, because that's exactly how the internet works itself. And so I think none of those aspects should detract from it at all, but they actually hold it up. And I think the other thing to learn from past processes is that, as Greg was, I think, alluding to, when you start to see the consensus, seize it. Seize that moment. Seize the consensus when you see it. And that is exactly the place where we are with this process right now. It's down to the last few issues, and it is high noon. It is time to seize the consensus while we have it, and wrap up on the remaining few items. And I have full confidence that we can do that as the internet community.
Thank you very much. Steve?
Yes, so to an audience of folks who are conscious of the government's role and the controversy there, I would have to remind them that ICANN's DNA is not going to change. It's still going to be led by the private sector, which is business and civil society and the technical community with a complete recognition of the appropriate role of governments when it comes to public policy. We are not going to change that basic part of the DNA, but we are asking governments to realize that their advice on things that are outside of public policy are going to be regarded in a significantly greater amount of deference than other areas, and that the advice given to ICANN, if it's inconsistent with ICANN's bylaws, well, then these governments shouldn't expect the community of global stakeholders to sit by and accept that. We'll challenge that decision by a board of directors that's under a lot of pressure, and we'll end up overturning a decision. So it's going to be incumbent on all of us in this co-equal set of community members is to try to keep ICANN focused on its mission and to understand that the global public interest in ICANN isn't determined by governments alone, but this multi-stakeholder group that may have a different view of the public interest than a government that wants to protect itself from, the rigors and threats of free expression on its ability to hold power.
Thank you. Steve Crocker?
Two comments, basically. When ICANN was created in 1998, quite a lot of thought was put into its structure. And the multi-stakeholder process and theme was absolutely central. Quite a lot's been said somewhat directly and quite a bit indirectly about empowering the community to be able to, say, overturn the board of directors and so forth, which skips over the idea that the whole structure of ICANN, as it was, as it has been, and as it's been operating, has been to be responsive to the community. So what's really going on here is a combination of a little bit of reinvention and sort of another layer of structure, and perhaps more gently, an evolution of the same theme that it was built with. So that's one comment. Probably more interesting for this particular moment in this session, the title for this session was High Noon. Let's move forward to the same time next year. And what is the title of this session next time? I think it's the morning after. Looking back on the IANA transition. And just like it's a little cheesy to take advantage of this blizzard that we're in the middle of here, or that we've just come through. We've had a couple of days, for those who haven't lived in Washington and the East Coast, we've had a couple of days of quite severe snow. The snow is over, but we have quite a bit of digging out to do. It'll be a little while before we're back to normalcy in terms of the traffic and the roads and everything, and schools and business and so forth. I think we have a period of time, I don't know how to gauge it exactly, but I think it's going to be measured actually in a couple of years' time as opposed to a couple of months or weeks, in which after the major events, the changing of the bylaws and the cessation of the IANA contract have taken place, that we're going to be going through adjustments, understanding of what the consequences were, of looking back and saying what it is that we really accomplished and taking stock. So I imagine that next year and the year after, for example, it will be an entirely appropriate topic of conversation to say, okay, what did we get for all of these enormous amount of time, energy, and money that we put into this transition, and to look at it quite soberly. So that's my closing comment. Next year's session is the morning after.
Thank you very much. David?
I'm not sure how I'm supposed to follow the next year being called the morning after, but I'm going to try anyway. As a House staffer, I'm going to give a couple pieces of advice. As it turns out, we know a little something about forming a committee made up of different caucuses and constituencies and ideologies, and making them sit down in a room and debate something until they get to something that people can live with. So as somebody who's done the majority chief counsel's job for 5 years, my last two pieces of advice is, when you get down to brass tacks, reduce the scope to only what is completely necessary to get to what you need, and bring in the detractors if they're willing to be reasonable. That's it.
Okay, Greg.
Thanks. Taking careful notes of Dave's advice, since I'm participating, you know, constantly, it seems, in the CCWG accountability. We're up to 2 3-hour full meetings a week, plus emails literally 24/7. I cleared my emails last night and woke up to 27 new email threads this morning, probably 50 emails. So it's, but that's an indication of how hard we're working. And it's actually, my last statement may have sounded a little bit dark or pessimistic, but I'm actually quite optimistic that with the level of thought and level of commitment that a lot of very intelligent people are spending on this from a variety of different communities, that we will get to where we need to get to, and we will get there in time. But I think we will need to follow advice like we just got from Dave, and we will need to come together. But I think that is what generally happens at the ends of processes like this, is that there is a certain galvanizing effect. And I think where we're heading into that, we are in that part right now. And I'm really, I'll be excited to see how things work out over the next few weeks, but it will be quite a wild ride, I think, as we close down these issues and really prepare ourselves to deliver what will be the proposal. Thanks.
Thank you. Chris Wilson?
Thank you. So I'm going to torture David's auto analogy a little bit and just say the rubber first meets the road really with ICANN when it comes to the internet and certainly the public-facing internet. And it's vitally important that we get this right, notwithstanding external pressures. Speaking for a company that has a vested interest of in the commercial internet for a variety of reasons, we want to see this done correctly, and I think we're on that track, due in no small part to the hard work of Greg and Steve Del Bianco. But we don't want, you know, this is just the start of the process, frankly, for all intents and purposes. I mean, once this gets done, yes, the contract expires, but now it becomes implementation time. And how, you know, what's the new ICANN? How is this thing going to roll out? And I think there's a lot of hard work left to be done on that. So notwithstanding the exhaustion from many, the beat goes on. So vitally important we get it done right, get it done correctly, so we can keep that car on the road for a long time. Thanks.
Okay, well, thank you very much. I want to close by thanking the State of the Net team for the conference. And it's so much work to make something like this happen. And then when you have a blizzard on top of it, I want to really applaud them for all the work that they've done to bring this together. So I will sign out from a snowy Chevy Chase and thank Alyssa Cooper, Steve Del Bianco, Steve Crocker, David Reddle, Greg Chatan, and Chris Wilson for a great panel. Thank you very much, and be safe, everyone.
Thank you.